It's morning at Jonathan Law.
And that means it's time for
Technical Difficulties. Yes, it's the show that nitpicks everyday phrases.
So you don't have to.
I'm Mr. Romelis.
I'm Mr. Zura.
Let's get technical.
Only on Eagle Eye Radio.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have breaking news this morning on technical difficulties. Webstergate 2018 is in full effect.
Oh, boy.
I know. This is not good, Mr. Romelis.
I'm feeling a little nervous right now. Listen, there are many things in history that that warrant this kind of music. I mean, listen to this. Oh, man. That implies some urgency. What's going on, Mr. Zura?
Well, last episode, we took a couple of shots at the folks at Merriam-Webster for their lack of response.
Right, because they didn't get back to us.
Because they didn't get back to us about the salad situation.
Right, right, right.
Well, it turns out that you and I might owe them a bit of an apology.
What?
Well, I happened to check after the show my spam folder in my email, which I never do. Who does that?
Nobody.
Nobody.
That's why it's a spam folder.
Which I don't even know why. I literally don't know why I did. And sure enough, 12 hours after my initial email to them, there was a response. So I'm
12 hours.
12 hours, not even a full 24. So I'm feeling like...
Are you saying that we might need to say a little something such as, I don't know...
I'm sorry.
Oh, yeah.
So sorry.
Oh, very geez. Sorry.
I really do hate apologizing, but you know what? This is a show about being technical.
Right.
Right?
And technically, we were wrong.
But we were only wrong about the fact that they didn't get back to us, and we were given shot. And listen, I
you really took them
to
the shed.
Listen, I took them to task. Yeah, I threatened to essentially... Took him to town. I essentially threatened to go to another dictionary.
You did.
You know,
an English one. I mean, like a British one. At that.
Yeah, yeah. Well, yeah.
Brutal.
The Oxford. I mean, like who even likes Oxford? Am I right? So I guess what we're saying is what I'm gonna say, especially because I was especially brutal.
I'm sorry.
Webster Dictionary, for my. My overreaction.
Yeah.
You did get back to us in a timely manner.
Extremely timely.
We lead with our mistakes, folks.
That's what we do,
and that's what good journalists do.
A number of episodes back, I led with my blunder of half-heartedly apologizing. This is more of a full apology this
time.
Yes. With that said, though,
okay,
it sounds like we're apologizing, but. So their answer to our submitted definition of salad did ease my concern partially ease my concern, because in their definition, if you remember, our issue was it didn't seem to address the possibility of a tuna salad or a seafood salad or lobster salad. And the guy who responded at the editorial department at Webster's Dictionary got back to me and said, yeah, but in our definition, we do imply, well, not imply, we do reference the word meat.
Mm-hmm.
And if you go to Webster's Dictionary definition of meat, Their general definition is essentially like the flesh of any animal, which would include seafood. So I'm going to give them the benefit of the doubt on that.
That's fine. However, Mr. Zura, I think there's a larger problem here. As you and I were talking before the show, what about our good friend south of the border, salsa?
That great friend of mine. Mr. Salsa.
No, you know.
The food.
In all seriousness.
No, I know. The problem is the definition that we submitted specifically references dressing being vinegar-based. And their definition, Webster's definition, does not.
Right.
So our response to them is going to be, how does your definition exclude a salsa from being considered a salad?
Right.
Because it has multiple vegetables and it's together and, you know, mixed together and all that kind of stuff. Because on any salsa I've ever had, a standard salsa, it's not vinegar-based, right? It's essentially lime juice and cilantro and tomatoes and onions.
Does the acidity get away with being considered vinegary? Well,
vinegar, it's its own thing.
I don't know. Did we actually look up the ingredients of salsa? Maybe we should have
We did.
Is there vinegar in it?
I don't know. Obviously, there's a million different recipes for vinegar. Right. But I mean, I think standard salsa is lime, cilantro.
So I think what we're trying to say here is that Webster Gate continues. And we will, of course, keep you updated as things develop.
We're not going down without a fight. Okay.
Well, we should probably end the show right there just because the music setup went so well.
It was well.
Unfortunately,
that's 2 weeks in a row we've had some dramatic music.
Very good.
From Pyeongchang to whatever that was.
By the way, welcome home from cold United Korea. The war is over, apparently. Fun fact, we are still technically at war with North Korea. There was never a treaty of peace signed. There is just a ceasefire, which is an armistice, right. I guess. So, guys, we're at war, technically.
With Webster's Dictionary.
Right.
Oh, yeah, yes. Okay.
Well, anyway.
So, on the show today, we have, it seems to become a usual thing for us, is our technical inbox.
Yes.
Just chock full of goodness.
Theme music still being composed for that technical inbox.
Yeah.
Yes.
Remember the first time we had a technical inbox?
Okay.
So the technical inbox, a student actually took issue with, I think it was episode 5, when we had Money Can't Buy Happiness and we Technically False and we...
this is the new technical inbox, right?
This is the current technical inbox. And we changed it to Money Can Buy. I guess there are a couple episodes behind if they're just getting to that one. But
well, that's all right.
Neither here
nor
there.
We've only promoted it in every possible way.
Signs and
multiple internet accounts. But okay.
Yeah, but that's fine. So his issue was, and I thought we would address it because I think he's got a... I don't know if it's a valid point, but it's enough that it made the inbox. It didn't get weeded out by our technical filter. Nope, that's not a thing.
Sorter filter.
Sort, like S-O...
Soda filter.
Nope.
What are you saying?
I don't know if his argument's that strong.
Gotcha.
That's what I'm saying. So his argument was he feels that money can buy certain types of happiness, but our phrase that money can buy happiness makes it sound like money can buy all types of happiness, which I guess there needs to be a discussion are there different types of happiness? First of all,
can I jump in on and with my analysis first?
You know that, yeah, yes.
That's, that's why I'm here.
That's,
right,
please. That's why I stopped.
Right. Co-host.
Period.
I gotcha.
Assistant. I thought it was assistant host. We'll talk about that later.
Assistant host.
Is that what? That
as was opposed what? To what?
Co-host.
Assistant. What are you? The head host. Don't make me get the urgent news music again.
No, there's not.
Oh, okay.
It is co-host.
You sure?
It is. I'm
because listen, if we have a crisis,
there's no no crisis.
All right.
No crisis.
So
I'm sorry. Co-host.
I don't have that song pulled up.
Oh.
Do you have it? I'm sweating over here from all the audio I'm doing. So, if I could address the this student's technical inbox. Okay, just because let me say this politely. I don't know how to talk to people. This is one of my problems in life. Let me say this as polite as I can. I understand that I'm hearing that you think that it makes it sound like money could buy all happiness. But just because you think that does not mean that is what it is saying, because it doesn't technically say that. It says money can buy if we said money can buy all happiness, your inbox is 100% valid, and I would even think to edit it.
Yeah.
But you are acknowledging in your inbox itself that money can buy certain types of happiness, and that's exactly what we said, is money can buy happiness.
I think he feels like it needs to be say that. But then we'd have to define what types of happiness there are and which types can be purchased by money. I think his example, just to give our listeners a little bit of a perspective, his example to me was sort of like if seeing like nature makes you happy, right?
Yes.
You walk outside and you got the mountains and our beautiful pine trees outside the studio,
right.
That kind of stuff.
Makes me happy.
I know. Yep. And I can't buy that type of happiness. That's, you know what I mean? Like, I can't buy.
That's literally up for debate in my mind, but yes, I know what
how
you're saying.
How so? Like, I could purchase trees and, I mean, what about like mountains and.
Sure
and,
can. You can buy lots of land if you have lots of money. Money could buy that.
All right, then. That settles that. That's pretty straightforward.
And listen. I think we have to invoke the 10th Amendment again, which,
okay.
You know, all rights not listed in this Constitution belong to the states, respectively,
yeah. Right?
Right. All possible definitions, as long as our definitions are technical fixes,
yep.
Or declarations, don't contradict something else, as long as they don't, then
sure.
it belongs to the individual who wants to interpret it. So, yeah. That's that. So, I think we
have... is there more breaking
sorry,
news?
No, it's just that...
I'm getting nervous
here. Chef Todd just walked in the room.
Oh,
the host of Meet the Press.
I know the reference. I don't know if... George Stephanopoulos, maybe?
Oh,
Tom
yeah.
Brokaw? We can go...
He's a fellow Greek, Stephanopoulos.
Fellow to who?
Oh, me.
Oh, you?
Yes.
Oh, that's nice.
Yep. He's the...
Athens or Sparta?
There's lots of other places in Greece. You don't have to... Insult my people.
Sorry. That's the theme of today's show. Breaking news or apologizing?
Breaking news is more exciting. Mr. Zura, is something ticking you off?
I thought you'd never ask, Mr. Mouse. You know what that means, folks. It's time for another technical tick-off segment.
Theme music not yet composed.
A lot of
we're behind, folks.
A lot of theme music we need. So, all right, this is perfect, all right? So you're drinking from a cup here, a Starbucks cup, right?
Yes.
Yes, you are. So you know how people, when it's like a psychological thing, when if you're given an image of a cup, a clear cup, and it's filled halfway with a liquid, right?
Right.
And some people say, oh, if you consider that half full, you're an optimist, and if you consider it half empty, you're a pessimist, right?
Yes.
You ever hear that?
Okay,
that
you're
idea,
such
that
a half person? Glass
yeah,
full.
Half kind of person.
Half
or, okay.
Empty.
You know what infuriates me about
what?
That? Is that there is zero interpretation to that. Here's what I mean. It's not a decision you get to make. If I have an empty glass
mm-hmm.
in front of me and I fill it halfway with water, it is now half full of water.
Mm-hmm.
If I have a glass that was previously filled and I drink or dump half of it out,
uh-huh.
Now it's halfway empty.
Right.
It's not an interpretive thing.
Right.
If I walk into a room where there is a glass that there's liquid halfway in it, I don't know. I can't make it, I can't answer if it's, do I think it's half full?
Oh, it's along the timeline of the existence of that liquid in the water.
To me, it's a...
In the glass.
It's a fact whether it's half full or half empty. It's not an interpretation of it.
Right. So if it is in the first place, let's go through the different modes of this.
Yes.
If it is in the first, here's empty glass.
Yep,
right
empty
here.
Glass. Doesn't
okay.
Sound empty.
It's full of ice and coffee.
Okay. But if it were empty.
But empty glass, right? I fill it with water halfway. It is indeed now half full compared to when it was fully empty. If you drink, if you fill it all the way,
yep.
It's definitely full. If you drink more of it.
Yep, half of it.
Half of it. It is then half empty. But now I'm thinking, I don't know, it's still, you could still look at it either way. It doesn't have to be considered.
Okay. So then, okay, then it's one or the other then.
Correct. It doesn't mean you're a pessimist or an optimist. I thought that's where you were going.
Well, it kind of is where I'm going.
Okay.
But I'm more on the, okay, I could even go the other way with that, right? If I have an empty glass,
mm-hmm.
and I fill
mm-hmm.
it up halfway, mm-hmm. it's half empty.
Sure.
And if I have a full glass and I empty it half, it's half or half full, whatever. It could work both ways, I think. My point is, it's not an indication of someone's pessimism or optimism.
Absolutely.
Or it shouldn't
yeah.
be.
Yeah,
it
yeah.
shouldn't
no,
be.
No, you're right.
It's
you're
literally
right.
a scientific, physical, either there was, it was a full, like, if I walk into a room, and
mm-hmm.
I don't know, but
mm-hmm.
it was
mm-hmm.
already full, and now it's down
mm-hmm.
liquid, or it was empty, and it's up liquid.
Right.
So that's what ticks me off. Is people's use of that as a
I see your point.
Gauge
are
of pessimism and optimism.
Are we agreeing, though, that half empty and half full are both correct, but just you cannot use it as a gauge.
As a gauge, yes.
For emotion or the type of person.
I'm okay with you, yes, taking a full glass and dumping it halfway out and saying it's still half full or it's half empty, either way, now that I think about it. But I'm still annoyed at people who think you're a pessimist or an optimist.
Okay. I'm totally on board with you.
The other thing to add to this, pessimism and optimism.
I was not expecting this.
The other thing to add to this is I think that being pessimistic is actually like the best form of optimism in a way.
Wow.
That's too philosophical right now?
It sounds like an extremely long conversation.
It is.
But can you summarize that?
I can't.
Good. So I'm glad you brought it up.
I'm glad I am too, because we were saying, though, I'm glad I did. We're going to leave that one on the back burner. Oh, no. Oh, no.
We just had breaking news.
Now what?
I'm bored.
Oh.
I need to stop talking about
this. Okay,
then. Yeah.
Well, then in that case, one last thing. Sure. No, it's not about pessimism, Rob. You're very pessimistic about the show.
But that means I am...
Kind of. I'll explain that in one episode. Anyone,
no, I would like to backburner that and get
really
to that.
Have
that's
a,
good.
A really good analysis of that. Don't forget that we teased our technical trivia contest that'll be coming up. Again, the details are in the works, but we will have.
I cannot wait for that. That's going to be good.
That's going to be great. We're going to have a preliminary round. We'll have some people in the finals. We'll do a live episode or live trivia finals on Eagle Eye News. So again, just be on the lookout for that. It'll be on Twitter. We'll explain it on the show once we get all those details worked out.
That is going to be, I believe, we sort of teased that for a little before AP test time, or are we going to do
that? Yeah, it's probably late April, April break.
Right. As you can see, we're even working it out on the air. But that should be fun, guys, and it's going to be a mix of both general trivia, technical trivia, and fan trivia, you know, making sure that you guys are listening for the solutions to the world's problems that we solve here every time we get on the air. All right, Mr. Zura,
Mr. Mills,
how you feeling?
I am feeling half full.
Wow. I'm sorry to hear that. The show is called Technical Difficulties. We thank you for listening. Please do not forget. Please don't forget to follow us at TD Eagle Eye Radio on Twitter, and we are also on the SoundCloud app at Mr. Zura.
/ Let's Get Technical.
Thanks, guys, for listening. I'm Mr. Amelis.
I'm Mr. Zura.
We will see you next time. Thank you guys for coming back. Thanks a lot, guys. Thank you. All right. Yep.